Okay.
Generations. And I was fortunate to have a number of good people in my life, including my mom,
And so the non-scriptural text that I did include actually came out of Bob's background as a member of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, a hymn that was taught to actually many generations, the hymn text, "I Am Jesus' Little Lamb." Now, I suppose I've committed a little bit of heresy because I've written a new tune for the one that for these words that have been sung by so many different generations. And yet, I wanted the children to have their own special moment. And it seemed to follow so well after the third movement, "People Feed His Flock Like a Shepherd." There also seemed, it just seemed to, as the piece was evolving, a need to have a soloist representing Jesus. And so the idea of just having, in a couple of scenarios, the first movement is Jesus in the English horn, which might be typical of a horn that would be played out in the pasture, representing those two. It's not a big, bombastic opening piece. If that's what you come for tonight, you're out of luck. It starts in a very simple, simplistic way, just with those two instruments. But also, in movement five, I found this text from Ezekiel 34, it is a little bit more startling nature. We talk about Jesus as a good shepherd, being very gentle and taking care of us in that way, nurturing, little pats on the back, but also there is that issue for a shepherd, kind of having to guard the sheep in days that are not so easygoing and the sun is shining. It's a little bit more challenging, I think, for the shepherd. But this text from Ezekiel seemed to bring a little bit of that contrast to the sweetness of the children's voices and also just the whole sense of Jesus being the nice little shepherd that holds us in his arms. Jesus protects us. And so when you listen to movement five, this would be the soloist. I myself will search for the sheep. You'll hear a couple of things. You'll hear a pattern in the bass line that just keeps going over and over and over and over again. Two or three measures, I should have looked it up before I came. This pattern in the bass line just keeps continuing. And the soloist singing the voice of Jesus talks about the sheep when they stray and they're scattered. And if you're listening very carefully, you'll hear the strings following the soloist. And so they're kind of following along as sheep would follow along. And sometimes when it talks about them being scattered, the strings start to scatter a little bit. And you'll hear a little bit of thunder in the clouds of darkness. So it's a little bit of a spookier, movement, if you will. From that, I want to certainly include the 23rd Psalm. Do you know how hard it is for a composer to write a setting of Psalm 23? There are probably a zillion settings that have been put out there, and I think probably our choirs have done maybe 1,000 less than that. And there are so many musical expressions. It's really intimidating to try to figure out how can there be one more setting. Psalm 23. There were a couple of things that I wanted to do. One was I wanted to include the children. And I'll tell you why. As a parish musician, I noticed at funerals that at one point in time, everyone could recite Psalm 23 from memory together. Some of you are nodding your heads, you may remember those days. It's getting harder to find that opportunity where we gather together and have everyone sharing from memory. My thought was, at the very least, if we could just teach the opening line from Psalm 23 to young people, it would be a way to encourage them to look further into Psalm 23. But even if they didn't go beyond that, they would still have that little piece of scripture that they could put in their pocket in life's journey. So it was really important to include, and you're going to be big stars. I can't wait to hear your voices as you sing the opening part of I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. For all the settings that are out there, it was very fascinating for me to see which words struck composers as maybe the key words in those last two lines. Follow me all the days, that might happen, and I will dwell. Dwell is a big word that would happen. I'm thinking of runner and a couple of others that have used the word, giving it either the highest quote or maybe the longest duration in the house of the Lord. Each composer actually did something different with those two lines. So that was kind of exciting for me. I figured I could do anything I want. I was, during the course of this whole compositional journey, working with Andrew Carter, who is an English composer, and I would send him some music and say, well, what do you think? Is it done? And he would say, oh, no, this is not a little Sunday anthem. You need to expand. You need to be more expansive. And I would think, rats. I was hoping I could go on to the next group. But we talked a lot about that whole sense of forever and ever. So you're going to see the influence of that here at the end of Psalm 23. That really worked pretty well then to lead us back to the John 10 passage. Once again, it's the soloist and the English horn, just those two. In theater, sometimes we call it the reprise, but this is using some of the same music, but a slightly different text. Where I am the gate for the sheep, I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. Life is actually, I believe, our soloist probably can confirm this, the highest note for the soloist. I think it's an A flat, or I think it's an A actually, all the way up there in the top part of the voice. And as that happens, we go immediately to the last movement. It was fascinating for me as I had the concordance and looked up everything like shepherd, sheep, all of the various references in scripture. The last reference that I found to shepherd was on the Revelation 7 passage, which you see is the last movement here. And for me, I found that very comforting, given the fact that as I was contemplating the relationship between the shepherd and the sheep, each of us, that relationship doesn't stop at death, but it goes on through eternity. And the Revelation 7 passage really kind of confirms that, and it worked perfectly. I would say it was providential in my case to have that work out, so that in my case, as I was contemplating eternal life from my Father, that I would be able to reflect on this text and see and be reminded that, yes, our relationship with the Good Shepherd is not just something during our little earthly journey, but is something that will go on through eternity. And so that's a little bit about the structure of this. I am not a text person. I am not a word person. I wish I were. And some of you may know the words of Susan Palo Churva. She's a hymn writer that lives in Minneapolis and is a dear friend. So when I kind of got things set up, I sent it off to her and said, what do you think, Susan? Does this seem to work? And she confirmed that the layout of the words would work pretty well. From there, I started writing the music for the choirs with either organ or piano accompaniment, just keyboard accompaniment. And then later, I was able to do the orchestrations. I love doing orchestrations, and perhaps as being an organist where you can pull on different colors and different sounds on the organ, you can also do it with instrumentalists too. And it's really cool when you have a good orchestra that can provide not only different colors, but beautiful different colors. So that was great fun for me to be able to do. I must say, and I have to admit this, because to my surprise, I have several choir members from Fort Wayne that have come down for this performance. So they they would publicly call me on it if I didn't share. I did not walk into the rehearsal room with a full score and say, here it is. What I did was I would finish one movement and we would start on it, and then we would get to another movement and start on it. And I think there were a couple of times in rehearsals, so you can correct me later if I'm wrong, that we started certain movements and I didn't even have the ending finished, but we had to get some notes finished. So the whole process, beginning of the text began probably in about October, and then the real writing began in late November, December, and I think the last movement, the revelation, who are these arrayed, I think, I'm scared to say, I think it was probably about 4 weeks before the performance in March at the evening prayer service when that was finished. And God loved the singers and Jeremy. They never complained once. They would just take the next piece of music, drip it in their feet, and they would say, okay, well, let's see what happens. I had another commission to finish for a church in Fort Wayne, a setting of Lift High and Cross, and I did that in February of that year, and once that was finished, I had 2 weeks to do the orchestration. And so God is good, and with deadlines, boy, did I feel the nudge of the Holy Spirit saying,
is our love for hymnody. And those of you who keep track of the church
know that today is Good Shepherd Sunday, and that was one of the reasons we programmed this work today. The fourth Sunday of Easter is always thought of as Good Shepherd Sunday, and we think of Psalm 23 and the many images of Good Shepherd. And so it's a delight to present the work of Good Shepherd. And it's important time to also thank those who make events like this possible. You will see in your program a list of several people who help support the series, and it would be possible to do that without their help. But in particular tonight, we sort of have what is for me is sort of an acknowledgement to Fort Wayne, Indiana, because not only is our composer from Fort Wayne, Indiana, but our concert sponsor is also from Fort Wayne, Indiana. Leonard Helfrich has been a dear friend of mine for a number of years, and he not only is a wonderful friend, but he's a wonderful supporter of the arts. In addition to supporting the arts in Fort Wayne, he has been so gracious to support the arts in Dublin. I think that is a beacon for us all, something we can all aspire to support the arts. And so, Leonard, please stand and let us thank you for providing. Lutherans, as we enjoy singing. So before we get to the main work of the evening, I'm going to enlist your help